On Monday, a new book comes out written by Matt Bai, who now writes for Yahoo News and was a political correspondent for the New York Times Magazine. The book is called The Truth Is Out, The Week That Politics Went Tabloid. And the focus is Gary Hart's withdrawal from the 1988 race for the White House, which came after it was discovered that he was having an affair with Donna Rice. Bai argues that the event was an important milestone in journalistic changes taking place since Watergate, where the surest path to media success had been to gain the trust of politicians and infiltrate their world. Now it was to take down a public servant through scandal. And you remember the photograph of Donna Rice sitting on Hart's lap? Chances are you think the photo was the smoking gun that killed his political career. Actually, the picture didn't come to light until nearly 3 weeks after he'd suspended his candidacy. In the ensuing 30 years, there's been no such thing as out of bounds when it comes to media interest in candidates for high office, and not just big media outlets. Take a look at what happened this week in Kansas. Paul Davis, the Democratic gubernatorial candidate, has been locked in a tight race against Republican incumbent Sam Brownback. 1 week ago today, a twice-weekly local newspaper with no website called the Coffeyville Journal revealed that in 1998, a then unmarried 26-year-old Paul Davis was in a strip club getting a lap dance when the place was raided as part of a drug sting. Davis was charged with no crime. This week he said that he was just in the wrong place at the wrong time. Davis was traveling with a partner at the law firm where he worked. The firm represented the club. And nothing in the police records suggests that either man violated the law. But you know that's not going to stop the story's circulation so close to Election Day. I worry not only about those who have entered the arena and now have their behavior placed under a microscope, but also those who are watching from the sidelines, maybe contemplating a willingness to serve, but seeing the treatment of others at the hands of the media, they decide that the scrutiny is just not worth it. This drains the pool of potential public servants and in many cases unnecessarily destroys the lives of those who submit to the 24/7 gauntlet. 4 years ago, I interviewed Gary Hart about a book he was then releasing, and I asked him where reporters and observers should draw the line today on covering politicians' personal lives. Here's what he told me. He said the standard that got changed, I think, 20 or 25 years ago was that a public person's private life was of importance only if it affected their ability to do their job. I think that was a pretty good standard, and it permitted some people who are flawed human beings, as we all are, to continue to serve their country. Well, I think he's right. And he also correctly pointed out that if today's wrecking ball standard had been applied in decades past, the country would have been denied the service of FDR, Dwight Eisenhower, and JFK, among others. It wasn't for us to condemn Hart. That was a job for his wife. And how ironic that while we rejected him, Lee Hart has stayed with him for more than 50 years. At least that's how I see it. But let me get another opinion from Tom Fiedler, who today is Dean of the College of Communication at Boston University, and 30 years ago, he was a political reporter for the Miami Herald. In fact, April 27, 1987, at 8 o'clock at night, his phone rang with the tip that would eventually sink Gary Hart. Hey, Tom Fiedler, thank you so much for being here. Was there any discussion at the Herald about whether this was a path the Herald should pursue or whether this should remain out of bounds because it was his private life?
There was extensive discussion about it, Michael. What really drove that story was the tip, which turned out to be verifiable and turned out to be accurate, is that Senator Hart, at a time while he was running for president, and by the way, while he also publicly was denying that he was engaged in what was kind of quaintly called womanizing back then, he was actually running around in a place, Turnberry Isle in Miami, which if they had done a reality TV show about Miami Vice, it would have been filmed probably in Turnberry Isle. So the question for us is, first of all, what is a presidential candidate doing running around in a place known to be awash in drugs, fast boats, fast girls, and so forth? And also at a time when he was denying that this was a problem for him. And by the way, as much as I admire Matt Bai and what he did, the fact that that E.J. Dionne's quote became somewhat iconic, Gary Hart had said many times before the E.J. Dionne interview words to those very same effects. So when you say that there was a myth that he had set his own trap, that's really not correct. I wouldn't use the word trap. But Senator Hart himself raised that issue as really a measure of who he was, of his own authenticity.
But the Herald wasn't responding. The Herald wasn't responding to that. The Herald wasn't responding to that challenge. You got a tip at 8 o'clock on that April night.
No, absolutely not.
But to have four reporters staked out literally in an alley, yourself included, trying to catch someone for infidelity who was a presidential candidate, that was unprecedented. And that's the point that I've tried to make.
What we were doing there, Michael, was verifying the tip that he, in fact, was going to spend the weekend with Donna Rice, which we verified. And you can only do that by actually being there. So, you somehow make it sound like what we were doing was out of the bounds of journalism, very much in bounds of what journalists do.
Right. The tip, however, was about infidelity. You make it sound like you could track down any tip. What was the
tip about?
It was about infidelity.
The tip was about lying. The tip was about lying. He had lied to everyone, the public included, that he claimed he was not engaged in this kind of behavior. That was the tip, that he was indeed engaged in that behavior, and we checked out the tip. We felt that it's important that voters be able to consider, when they're looking at a person's fitness for office, they should be able to take into account what his character included, and it included lying about, as it happened, infidelity.
Thank you so much for being here. We appreciate your time.
But really, lying is the heart of the issue.
After the break, scaring the public into the voting booth. Let's call it for what it is, the politics of fear. We'll examine how politicians are using acts of terror and the airstrikes against ISIS to influence voters. We're back in a moment.